Good afternoon, good evening, everybody. I'm sorry. I believe we had a very, very fantastic Christmas celebration. The year is winding up. It's just 4 more days to the end of the year. Sister Anita, Brother Adebayo, good evening, Ma and Sir. The broadcast could not be late tomorrow. It will be very much earlier tomorrow. My schedule tomorrow permits me to have a very very early broadcast. Today is going to be explosive. Brother Yomi, good afternoon. Good evening, sir. Sister Fumi, good evening, sir. Good evening, ma'am. Today will be explosive, and I'm winding up on the value system series, and so the momentum is building up. I've got a lot of stuff to say, and the momentum is building up, and I believe we have all learned so many things. And someone out there is saying the people that are actually responsible for the rots and the decadence in our beloved country. Oh, wow. Thank you, my brother. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Well, I'm looking for an opportunity. I might most likely do a book on this series. And writing a book is not very easy. It's a very difficult work to do. I've written some books, and more are still coming next year. So I'm most likely going to transcribe this series and then engage my publishers, and we just do some editings. This book needs to go into Africa. It needs to go into Africa. I've touched on so many sensitive issues, ritual killing, abuses, I mean, all kinds of stuff. So imagine, us having a book as big as this, a compendium of knowledge that has different chapters of value system. So I began to think about it, and I told my wife, and looking at something we can do. It's a lot of work, and I'm going to get somebody to transcribe, and then we flesh it out and do some things. God helping me and helping us. And so today is going to be very powerful. I'm trusting the Holy Spirit to help me. I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I say, like Jesus said. And I want you to help me share this message. I've got something very, 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 very strong on my heart, and I want to say it to the body of Christ listening to me. I have narrowed down on Nigeria being the largest country in Africa. In terms of population, in terms of economy, Nigeria takes the lead. Now, taking the lead doesn't mean that Nigeria is doing the best, but at least in terms of volume, in terms of size. And so if we can fix Nigeria, we can fix Africa. If we can fix Nigeria, we can fix Africa. And that is the reason why I'm using Nigeria as case studies every time. I could have used Ghana or South Africa. I've got contacts. I've lived there as well. But I'm in Nigeria myself. And so the burden on my heart is to see that country change. Sometimes when you look at the level of rot, you are tempted to make negative confessions that there is no hope. When you look at the level of rot and decadence, particularly in the church. Now, if the world is rotten and the church is clean, and you have a measure of hope in your heart, and you are happy that the lights in the church will touch the world. But when the church is now crumbling, and I am not generalizing now, I'm not saying everybody in church is crumbling. There are great people in Nigeria, great pastors. But Jesus gave a proverb that I always use as analogy. Jesus said, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. If you have ever baked anything, my late mom used to be a caterer. So my late mom used to be a caterer. I learned a lot of catering from him. I can bake cake. I can do whatever. I've forgotten. I've become rusty now. But we used to sit with her. And so she would put a big amount of flour in a basin, put all the stuffs there, and add a little bit of yeast there. By the time she stirs it up, pushes the stuff into the oven, and a portion of flour as small as this swells up because of a little yeast. So that is what a little poison does in a system. So it is only a very foolish manufacturer. A very foolish manufacturer that sees a little bit of error in a manufacturing process and allows it to go through. No, if you are working with white people, if you have worked with white people, if I have worked with many of them, they will not allow one inch of error to enter their process. Because that one inch of error can produce a geometric effect of anomalies. And a white man will not wait to pay the price of error. They will correct the error from source. That is one problem black men don't have. We are not proactive, we are reactive. They are two different things. There are two different things. There is a difference in being proactive, preventing something, and being reactive after the damage has been done, you start to correct it. That is the problem we are having in Africa now, and particularly in the body of Christ. Now, we are now being reactive now. Years ago, when that problem was being identified, many people's mouths were shut, and the big people would tell the younger ones, what do you know? Who do you know? Keep quiet. Don't talk about it. Keep quiet. Now, I read something online few days, just today, and a big man of God that I respect so much said something and said, nobody should talk about the fault of any man of God. You remember what God did to, it mentioned one man in the scripture, Old Testament. Don't talk, just leave them to go, go correct them. I mean, and I just slapped, I didn't make any comments. It's a man I respect. I said, this is the same thing that has led us to where we are today. Now, if you have a friend that is going astray, you two of you are at the same level, and you refuse to correct him, and you endorse what he's doing, and you are not talking about it, and somebody younger than him is trying to speak, and you're shutting him down, that don't speak about it. Now, if you have an eternal perspective of issues, and the destinies of hundreds of millions of people, they are very important to you. You will have compassion in your heart, and you will address issues. There is a difference between addressing people's personality and insulting them, which is against the scripture. You have to respect everybody. I have taught on this platform the principles of mutual respect. You must respect everybody, young, old, poor, or rich. That was what Jesus stood for. That is what it still stands for. Everybody must be respected. But when it concerns doctrinal issues, when it concerns the water, the river that everybody is drinking from, and you notice that somebody has dropped a poison in a public river, and then you shut your mouth, you're in big trouble now. God will demand the blood of those people from your neck, because you know and you saw it there. So that is what we are doing, and God is raising up an army of people across the globe in our own domains, in our own areas. Let's do something. Write a small book, do an article, and I am pushing myself into the secular and into the spiritual as well, because there are some of our brothers who are not Christians. We have to be able to reach them. So when you begin to quote scriptures, you lose them. So sometimes I have to put things in perspective and tell them, value system is value system. Whether you are a Christian or you are a Muslim, telling lies is wrong. Sleeping with another man's wife is wrong. Giving bribe is wrong. So you don't need to be a Christian to know that value systems are value systems. And like I shared with us some days back, a very big pastor in Nigeria was traveling to England. And he had traveled many times and had used multiple passports. So the picture on his first passport, he looked quite young there. So when he got to the immigration desk, the young man at the immigration looked at him, looked at his picture, looked at him, and said, are you sure that he wanted this passport? And the man of God said, I am a man of God. I can't be telling lies. I am the one I'm talking about, the first three, four leading pastors in Nigeria, in quotes. You know, he's a big pastors. I won't mention his name. He said, I'm a man of God. I can't be telling lie. It is my picture on the passport. And the young man at the desk said, so do you mean that if you're not a pastor, you'll be telling lie? The man was surprised. The man said, he looked at the boy like this. Ah. So that man is a British man. In their own value system, you don't have to be a pastor to know that lie is wrong. You don't have to be a pastor to know that abusing people is wrong. You don't have to be a pastor to know that bribery is wrong. Their own foundation, their founding fathers in their country, they build their societies on the principles of integrity and dignity. Whether you are a Buddhist or an Hindu or a Christian or a Muslim, there are things that you don't do. But because we have given religion the topmost priority in our nation in Africa, when somebody behaves well, he's a Christian. When somebody behaves badly, he's not a Christian. And so this evening, there is a very important subject I want to address. You see, like I've always said to us, one man is very powerful. One man. I want you to see yourself as a change that Africa needs. I want you to see yourself as a change that the African continent needs. What can I do? You can do a lot. Do you remember the story of Daniel and Joseph? Daniel did not have a Bible. Daniel lived in the most wicked country on earth at that time, Babylon. Babylon at that time is today's Iraq. Nebuchadnezzar was one of the most ruthless and wicked kings that the world has ever seen. Nebuchadnezzar will throw people into the lion's den and be watching them being eaten alive by lion. Nebuchadnezzar will cut people into pieces. And he demonstrated it in the time of Daniel. Set up a fiery furnace, set up a lion's den. Daniel had no Bible, but Daniel behaved himself. Joseph had no Bible. Joseph knew that sleeping with another man's wife was wrong, but he had no Bible. That was why Jesus was speaking to the Pharisees and was saying that Sodom, it will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah than for many of you. Because if Sodom and Gomorrah had had some of the messages that you are hearing today, Sodom would have repented. Dr. Billy Graham said something one time to America. Billy Graham said, he said, God will have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah if he doesn't judge America. He said, God will have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah if he doesn't judge America. And I think the same thing applies to Nigeria. God owes Sodom and Gomorrah an apology if he doesn't judge Nigeria. Because it's a righteous God and it's a faithful God. And this evening, I have come to us with a proposal. It is still the same kingdom series. How Nigeria's 85 million Christian population can turn Nigeria from a third world country to a first world country in 5 years. Do you think that is impossible? 85 million Christians, Catholic, Anglican, Presbyterian, Protestants, whatever, Pentecostal. At least statistics tell us that we have 85 million. There could be more than that, I'm not sure. Plus or minus 5% or 10%. 85 million people. And there is virtually no impact in that nation. Things are getting worse. We have reached the tipping point of moral decline. What somebody calls a cesspit of debauchery. That is when a society gets to a point, it is a state of total moral collapse. The age of anything goes. That is what one first-class apostle and Bible scholar calls this present society. The day of anything goes. Anything goes in the Church of Christ. Anything goes. There is no rule. There is no standard. There is no law. Everybody does whatever they like. Everybody does whatever they like. And it is a sign of divine judgment. Anytime people begin to behave the way they like, and it appears as if God is not concerned, it is a judgment. When God keeps quiet over any generation, it is judgment. In the book of Malachi, from the book of Malachi to the book of Matthew, it's a period called intertestament period. Intertestament between the old and the new. 400 years. God did not speak a single word to Israel. There was no prophet. For 400 years, God was quiet. And everybody in the whole world began to do whatever they like. Anytime there is silence in heaven, and people begin to behave the way they like, and nobody is speaking, it is a severe consequences. And that's judgment. So when people begin to speak, and people are shutting them down, it is a mark of blessing. That God is raising you, God is raising me, God is raising people all over the world to speak out, to encourage Christians, to mentor people. It is a sign of divine favor. Because when heaven shut down and everybody's mouth keeps quiet, it is a mark of judgment. But we thank God for his mercy. God is giving us a second chance. Why is it impossible for 85 million Christians to change a nation of what, 80 million or 200 million, when only one man, Daniel, fixed Babylon, when only one Joseph fixed Egypt. These guys didn't have access to tape, to CDs, to books, to Google, to Facebook, to Twitter, to Instagram. Yet they changed their nation. Now, how do we stand before God as a nation, as a people? And Daniel is standing, Joseph is standing, and Nigerians too are standing before God and beating their chest. We built 50,000 sister capital auditorium. We built 10 million sister auditorium. And God is shaking his head in heaven. But Daniel had no Bible, and he fixed the issue of morality in Babylon. Joseph was a baseline for integrity in Egypt. Joseph was a baseline. Nobody was watching Joseph. Joseph was face to face with an opportunity to sleep with another man's wife. He had all the authority to do it. The man committed everything into the hand of Joseph. He had no Bible, no Facebook, no message, no mentorship. He was in a barren land. But Joseph stood for integrity. So what do you think God will say to you, to me, Africans, 85 million Christians in Nigeria, and the country is disintegrating into a state of total moral collapse, the age of anything goes? It is a very serious thing, and prophecies are coming out all over the world. God is sending people, raising people. Many of them, their mouths are being shut. Because, like I said yesterday, Saul's generation will never hold their peace for David to reign. They want to kill David. But God, in his infinite mercy, knows how to preserve David. And so I felt led this evening to tell you something. What are the characteristics of a third world nation? Many countries in Africa today are regarded as third world nations, including Nigeria, with all the big companies, with all the big houses, big cars. These are not the metrics for determining whether a country is first world or third world. Any country that has high rate of illiteracy is a third world country. Nigeria has 75 million people that are regarded as illiterate. 75 million illiterate. Now, even among the group of people that are literate, we have people we call educated illiterate. People with master's degree who know nothing. People with bachelor's degree who come on Facebook and exhibit foolishness and extreme ignorance. People who see black and call it white. People who see white and call it black. The worst state of dishonesty is when a man gets to a point, he tells himself a lie. Dr. David Jeremiah said, the worst state of dishonesty, the worst state, legendary state of dishonesty is when a man gets to a point, he tells himself a lie. You tell yourself, you are in a private room, nobody's watching you. You are telling yourself a lie. You know that this thing is wrong. My pastor is wrong. What he's doing is wrong. And you are alone in the room. And you are still saying, yes, he is right. It is the worst state of dishonesty. You are not just dishonest to people. You are dishonest to yourself and doing yourself a disservice. So we have a very big problem. And we must continue to speak out so that the future of the next generation can be salvaged. So that the future of the next generation can be salvaged. God is a strategic thinker. God doesn't think 10 years. God doesn't think 20 years. When God is thinking, he's thinking 5,000 years ahead. So, when God is making plans, he's looking at transgenerational consequences of what people are doing. So, he looks at a generation and looks 50 generations ahead. The influence and the impact of what somebody is doing, if it's going to damage future generation, God removes him, raises somebody else, and sends him on that assignment. So if you want to work with God, you must be transgenerational in your thinking. You don't just look at what you are seeing now, the people you are seeing now. Look at the children of 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 those that are alive. What will happen to Nigeria in 2070 if Jesus tarries? Where we live in a generation now, where people are calling black white and are calling white black, what will happen in 2070 when me and you may not be alive again? I don't think I'll be alive in 2070. I don't think so. Many of us listening to me would have gone to heaven. What will happen to our children? What if some of us are living abroad, living in America, in the UK? What if something happens tomorrow and the UK government says every foreigner in our country that we have even given citizenship to, we revoke the citizenship, go back to your country. And many of us have already gone to heaven and our children are living abroad and they have to relocate to Africa. What is going to happen to them? That is why God is a transgenerational thinker. So when you think about issues, think about it strategically. Don't look at it from your own point of view. You are comfortable. Everything is okay. What is going to happen to people in the next 70 years? What will happen in the next 100 years? These are the kind of people God is looking for. People who can see what God is seeing, who think what he's thinking, who perceive what he's perceiving. That is having a selfless approach to issues. Not just me, myself, and I. So when I look at issues, I am looking at consequences of what you are doing. That is what the Japanese taught us. Now, being a process engineer, they taught us the ripple effect of deviation. They taught me in engineering that one millimeter changes in the diameter of a ball can result to 10 millimeter error at the end of the process. So at the beginning, once you see a little deviation, you must stop the process. You stop the process, identify where the error is, correct it, and then restore the process. That is where Japanese people think, and Chinese, they will not wait until the thing will destroy them 10 years after. They collect it from the source. So any nation where you see high rate of illiteracy, high rate of poverty, poor and dilapidated infrastructure, low quality of education, high rate of corruption, low GDP, high crime rates, high rate of unemployment, low level of productivity, poor quality of product and services, social backwardness, which include ritual killings, armed robberies. Any nation you see that fit into this picture is called a third world nation. It is a third world nation. Now, I got a statistics that the United Nations estimates that for a country to work, for a society to work, it needs to be productive to about 50% or 40%, no, about 25%. At least 20 to 25% of the population must be working and working hard. That is the estimate. 20 to 25% of the population must be working and working hard. And regrettably and sadly, they did an analysis in Nigeria and observed 0.2% of the population are working and working hard. What are the rest of the people doing? We are going to church. We are making confession. We confess and confess and confess until we become confused. What are the rest of the people doing? They are confessing their way to greatness. 0.2% of the population are productive. And the minimum standard set by UN is 20%. That is not the maximum standard, the minimum for a nation to work. 20%. That is one out of every five people must be working hard. Go to work in the morning, close by 5 or 6, and even at work, you are working hard. And they did an estimate in Nigeria. They said 0.2% of the population are working hard. 0.2. Where are the rest of the people? What are they doing? They are confessing. They are sowing seeds. They are believing for aeroplane to land and bring resources to their houses. And that is a clear sign that many African nations are third world nations. Nigeria being the headquarter. Being the headquarter. Forget about all the big houses, big cars. Nigeria has the tallest building. All those ones are irrelevant things. They don't measure. If you go to the airport in Lagos today in Nigeria, you see hundreds of people there. And there are thousands of people all across the embassies. The Canadian embassy keeps refusing visa. US embassy refusing visa. People do all kind of dubious documentation to get visa. If the country is working and is peaceful, people will not be refused visas. People will not be leaving the country en masse. And so, now the question I want to ask you today is this. And I've answered this question many times, but for the sake of my friends, listen to me for the first time. How does this thing concern the church? What is my business? The government makes money. They have oil. They have minerals. They have all kinds of money coming in. Why should the church be concerned? Is that not what many pastors are saying in Africa today and Nigeria? It doesn't concern me. How should I use that an offering that I'm making, my people are bringing, and be using it to help the country? What is the role of the government and the role of the church? And I've answered this question many times, and I'm going to answer it tonight for you to know that Jesus left you and I a mandate to fix the society. It is a mandate. Let me tell you something. Jesus came into this world for only one thing: to preach the gospel of the kingdom. It is the gospel of the kingdom that provided salvation for you and I, that provided all the kingdom value systems that will help us to live a very successful life and an impactful life. There is nothing like the gospel of prosperity. It is not what man says that matter, but what God says. There is nothing like the gospel of holiness. There is nothing like the gospel of deliverance. Jesus didn't hand over any gospel of holiness to anybody. He only came to preach one gospel. And he gave you and I and every other Christian and minister and preacher the mandate to preach and teach and live by the gospel of the kingdom. Mark chapter 1 verse 14. And Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. Matthew 24, 14. And Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. And he said again, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, and then the end will come. That is the foundation of the problem we are having in the body of Christ in Africa that has made the church less effective. If at all, it is even effective. Very few people understand the concept of the gospel of the kingdom. So many people have developed their own gospel, their own variants, their own ideas of the gospel. And they come out and tell you, Jesus appeared to me and gave me the gospel of holiness. He appeared to me and gave me the gospel of this and that and this and that. And all of them are not saying what the scripture has said. Any revelation, any prophecy, any word that anybody gives you, including telling you that Jesus appeared to him and he contradicts the scripture, it is not Jesus. The Bible says Satan himself appears as an angel of light. Satan can appear as light, wearing white clothes, with sun, with everything, and he will give you a word. Any revelation that does not line up, any rhema that contradicts the logos of the word, it is not from God. So when you are so worded and you are so sound and loaded with scriptures, some of those things will not move you. They don't move me. There's no amount of rhema that can move me against the written word, because the written word is the baseline for evaluating the truth. The written word is the baseline for evaluating the truth. So you can't come and tell me, I saw Jesus, I saw 12 angels, they came to my room. It doesn't matter. If what you have said, they have told you, contradict the written word, I trash them. I just trash them. We have every evidence we need to have to know those who are saying the truth or those who are not saying the truth. There is only one authentic gospel. It is called the gospel of the kingdom. It is called the gospel of the kingdom. Every minister of God, whether you are a prophet, an evangelist, a teacher, an apostle, every Christian, whatever you are, an accountant, an engineer, you are a kingdom diplomat. You know what a diplomat is? Like an ambassador of a nation. You are heaven's representative on earth. And you have only one role: to be the channel through whom these kingdom values will flow into the society. And that is what can transform a nation. If you look at Colossians chapter 1 verse 13, the Bible says he has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. A complete change of position. You have been repositioned. You are not where you used to be. You are not in a different kingdom. And Jesus gave us a mandate. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. The kingdom is the paramount thing, is the foundation. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Now, that word means and his ways of doing things, or and his value systems. So he's saying, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his value systems. And everything you need, including money, houses, influence, fame, will be added unto you. So giving kingdom values priority above everything that that is taught in our churches will transform our nation. And many pastors don't even know this thing at all. They go to all kind of brainwashing Bible schools that tell them this, all kind of useless things that diminish the value of Jesus' mandate. Seek ye first the kingdom and his value system. Jesus himself said it. It is written in red in my Bible. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom and his value system. Righteousness means his way of doing things, which means the value system of heaven. And all these things shall be added unto you. Let me tell you something. Every one of you listening to me, you have been sent to this world to occupy a particular sphere of influence. Some of us have been sent into the mountain of religion. Some have been sent into the mountain and influence of education and academics. Some have been sent into the mountain of finance. Some are in the mountain of science and technology. Some have been sent into the media world. Some have been sent into entertainment. Some have been sent into the arts world. Now, in all of these mountains, as a Christian or as a pastor, everywhere you go, regardless of your mountain, your agenda and primary goal in life is to be the channel through whom this kingdom value system will flow. This kingdom value system, whether you are a doctor or an engineer, when you are encountered by anybody, by your patients, by your student, you should be heaven's representative or not. When people see you, you should be emitting kingdom values. Kingdom values. Kingdom values. Kingdom values. And all the people who don't know Christ, all the unbelievers, all the Hindu people, all the Buddhists, when they see you, they see little Jesuses. They see little Jesuses around. And that is what will change the society. Now let me tell you this question. Is there any relationship between the church and society? Is there any link between the church and society? Let me tell you something. There are seven different areas. There are seven different ways by which Christians in Africa are influenced in their church. Seven different areas. Seven. Believers go to church. They listen to messages on Sundays and weekly. Christians go to church. They buy CDs, they buy tapes, they buy books. Christians listen to messages on social media. Christians go to workers' training, Sunday schools in their churches. Christians attend Bible schools. Christians interact with church leaders, with friends, with colleagues in their churches. So every one of these avenues is an opportunity for the leaders of churches to model and mentor kingdom values into the Christians. So if on a Sunday service, the pastor comes on the altar and teaches kingdom value systems, all the messages, all the prophecies, all the teachings, they are all directed towards kingdom value systems. I will tell you what they are now. Across all the churches where 85 million Christians go to, and this is continued every month, every year, within the next 5 years, we have several millions of Christians who have been brainwashed by kingdom value systems. But the opposite is the same now. The opposite is the same. Now, when they go to churches, they are not taught kingdom values. They are taught personal selfish values. Egocentrism, selfishness, how to use God, how to hijack God, how to exploit God, how to double cross God. And if people are being taught to such values, they translate it into society, in their offices, in their hospitals, in their universities. They look for how to exploit people, how to double cross people. Now, do you see how critical and strategic the role of pastors and Christian leaders are? The religious institutions are one of the most critical avenues for value systems development. It has been documented. Religious institutions, because these people are in charge of the destinies, the lives, the mindset, the thinking, the goals, the objectives, the aspirations of 85 million people. So you and I and every other Christian be it a Christian leader, we have only one mandate: to go and preach the gospel of the kingdom, to make the values of the kingdom priority. And you ask this question: if these things are written in scripture, why are all our preachers, a vast majority of them, not kingdom minded? Why are they denominational minded? Why are they my church minded? Why are they my empire minded? Because kingdom driven thinking is a natural cure for greed. When you think kingdom, you can't think greed. You can't think covetousness. When you are thinking the kingdom, because the kingdom of God is God's domain, God's way of thinking, God's way of making business. There was one day I was going somewhere and I found the purse of a white woman. The purse was as big as this. All manners of credit card. No, I went to a store. I went to a store and I found all manners of credit cards. And when I saw it on the floor, without hesitation, I said to myself, if Jesus was going to a store and he saw the purse of someone, he will put the purse in his pocket. I took the purse to the customer service desk, and I, being a black, when I dropped the purse on the desk and I told them I found this purse, they looked at me with bewilderment. Said, "Ah, thank you very much." And I said, no, don't thank me. It's not my own. When you pick the purse of a white lady, dozens of credit cards. The credit cards were even showing outside. I was seeing them, MasterCard, Visa card, and I took it. I'm not saying this to impress you. I'm telling you that you get your life to a point where you are thoroughly brainwashed by kingdom value system. Whether they are watching you or not watching you, wherever you are, you see yourself as heaven's representative on earth. Jesus cannot be caught sleeping with another man's wife. Jesus can't be caught giving bribes. Jesus can't be caught stealing people's money. So I'm not saying we don't make mistakes, but the nucleus of your life, the core of your life, is integrity. Even when you make mistakes, you acknowledge that I have made mistake. You acknowledge that I have made mistake. And when people accuse you that you are wrong, you don't try to negotiate around the truth. You don't negotiate around the truth and try to explain it. You are wrong, you are wrong. And that is one of the pillars of integrity. A man of integrity is not a man that doesn't make mistake. It's a man that acknowledges that he has made mistake and is willing to change. That is the pillar of integrity. Integrity is not the absence of error. Integrity is the acknowledgement of error. And a readiness, having the readiness to stop doing what you are doing. That is called integrity. And so, this is a very core principle, core pillar of the Christian faith. Kingdom value system. Do you know what happened to Nigeria as a nation? If all bishops, all evangelists, all pastors, all evangelists, all prophets go to their altars on Sunday and they begin to teach people and begin to train people, kingdom value system. What are these kingdom value system? Let me tell you something. Galatians chapter 5, verse 21 and 22 gives us a picture of the kingdom value systems that Jesus has given us a mandate to teach. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, meekness, gentleness, and it highlights all this value system. If you pick only one of them, which is called love, that one alone is enough to fix Nigeria. That one word called love is enough to fix Nigeria. Now, when you talk about the word love, I'm not speaking of lust now. Love. There is a difference between love and lust. When you talk about the word love, we are talking about unconditional love, unflinching appetite to love God unconditionally. Imagine if all Christians in Nigeria, 85 million of them, are like Daniel, are like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These people didn't have Bible. They don't have access. They didn't have access to social media. They confronted them with death. At the point of death, they were willing to die for the truth. How many of us are willing to die for the truth? How many Nigerians are willing to be disgraced for the truth? How many people online, on Facebook, are willing to physically acknowledge the truth? Many of them will acknowledge the truth in their rooms. When they come to the public, they are very afraid. You don't negotiate with truth. You don't negotiate with it. You don't negotiate with the truth. So this one word, love, the word, if every pastor are living this word and are mentoring and modeling every member, whether you are a Catholic or an Anglican or Pentecostal or Protestant, across all our churches, all over Nigeria, and they are mentoring people and teaching them love, sacrificial love, love the people, love the lepers, love the poor, love the government, love your neighbors. Love naturally kills greed. When you love people, you cannot offend them. Even if you offend them, you are looking for every opportunity to apologize to them. Love kills covetousness. Love will make people that are doing rituals, ritual killing. Can you love people and use their child for rituals? Can you love people and use their husband and wife for rituals? You won't do it. When a man is in love, it is worse than being on alcohol. Love drives people crazy more than alcohol. Love, when love has entered you, when you are injected with love, it drives people crazy. Look at the love between husband and wife. Look at the love between man and a woman. A man will do the most foolish thing in the world because he wants to please the woman. The woman will do the most unimaginable thing. We have had cases where a woman will use her own tuition fee to pay the tuition fee of the man he wants to marry. And he will leave herself, empty because he loves the man. Now imagine all pastors teaching love. Don't curse your enemies. Love your enemies. Pray for your mother. You go and meet your mother in the village. Go and show her love. Go and show your bosses love. Don't go to work. When you love, when you have love, you won't go to work late. Work ethics will be affected. When you have love, when your bosses are not watching you, you will make sure you do their work very well. It is absence of love that makes people to do shady and shoddy work. When your boss is watching you, you do things very well. When he's not there, you begin to do things very well. When he's not there, you do shady and shoddy jobs. When he's there, you sit up. Love is the strongest force, and it is a value system. Imagine all the pastors that are ripping people off, manipulating them, telling them lies, sleeping with women. If they get inoculated and injected with love, and they begin to replicate the same to their members, give Nigeria 5 years. Give Nigeria 5 years. It will not just transform that nation. It will spill over to all the other nations. It will spill over. That is just one value system. That is just what. There are many value systems in that verse. That word love, it can fix that country. And so back to my initial question, what is the role of the church in the society? The government is making money. Why should the government neglect its role and the church should take it over? Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom and its value systems, and all other things shall be added. When you are possessed by the spirit of love, you are not in the position to be asking questions. Anything wrong that you see around you, you fix it. Whether the government is doing it or not, it's not your problem. Immediately you are in love, you cannot set your eyes on evil and be at rest. You can't set your eyes on the hungry and be at rest. You can't set your eyes on the weak and be at rest. You don't even have time to go and make inquiry. As the government help them, immediately you see problem, you want to solve it. That is the power of love. Immediately you see problem, you want to solve it. You don't have time to be asking questions. The allocation of this government to this state is 20 billion. They have stolen the money. You don't care. When you see poor people, you see the derelict, you see the delinquent, you want to help them. That is kingdom value system of love. And it will spill over to all universities, all manufacturing industry, all TV stations. Everybody manipulating people will stop because they're in love. Lecturers will stop sleeping with students. They're in love with Christ. Love, you love those students as your children. When you love them, you won't defile them. You won't abuse them. all the lecturers that make students fail, and they come to class and tell them, you will fail my course. When you are injected with the spirit of love, the value system of love, you go to the lecture room and train those children as your own children. You want them to succeed. Look at the power of love. It will transmit into police, transmit into security system. Judges will not collect bread again. When an armed robber comes to a judge and gives him money, take $1 million, twist the case, let it favor me. The man is in love. He said, I cannot do it. When you are in love, it will affect every area of society. It will kill greed, kill covetousness. It will eliminate egocentrism. Imagine if all pastors that are prophets, evangelists, bishops, apostles in Nigeria dive into the kingdom value of love. They are not just preaching it, they are also living it. Their members are seeing it. They take care of their members. When people are in need in church, they help them out, even to their own hearts. Because the love we are speaking about here is not lost. It is Jesus' kind of love. The love that will make a king to leave his throne in heaven and come to die on the cross. That is a kind of love, selfless love, sacrificial love. If this kind of love is in place in our churches, we will fix that nation in 5 years. We will fix that nation in 5 years. I cannot count how many people, with the little money that God has given me, the little, I can't even remember. Hundreds. Different people, different. If I have only $5 in my pocket and I see people in pain, I lose my patience. I don't bother to ask, what is your government doing? You can't be in love and be asking that question. What is your government doing? Which government? I am heaven's representative on earth. Anywhere I am and there is a problem, I must fix it. Imagine pastors training people and telling them, anywhere you are a kingdom diplomat. You must fix the problem. 85 million people will go into the society. They will be fixing things, fixing roads, fixing hospital, fixing schools. They will be fixing it because pastors are telling them the right thing. You are heaven's representative on earth. What will Jesus do if he's going on the road and he sees a leper on the road? Will he walk by him? He will fix that boy. Fix that girl. That is what love does. That's any country you see where there is plenty of problems, but a large Christian population, they don't know love. All they know is a caricature of love. Caricature is not love. It is just mere rhetorics. No rhetorics. Sweet languages. Sweet words. Oh, we love people. It is not by mere rhetorics. It is sacrifice. If Jesus used rhetorics and was saying, I love these people. Oh, I'm the son of man. And on the day of death, he ran away. You and I will be in hell today. That is what is called kingdom value. And that is just one. There are about 7 or 9 of them in Galatians chapter 5. The value systems that can transform a nation. Love. And the Bible arranged it and put love as number one. There is something called the law of first mention in scripture. The law of first mention. Anything that is mentioned the first time, pay attention to it. So it was not just arranged carelessly. The Jewish scribes that wrote the Bible, they put love as number one. There is another value system in that scripture called meekness. Another word for meekness is humility. Humility. That one is lacking in the African continent. Humility. You know what humility can do to a nation? Imagine if all pastors, pastoring the 85 million Christians in Nigeria, if they go to their altars on Sunday and they come down from the high pedestal where they are, they break down all the barriers. People have access to them. Jesus needed a Judas to identify him. Listen to this. If Jesus was different from the apostles, why would he need someone to identify him to the Pharisees? He looked the same way. He wore the same dress. They ate the same food. He and the apostles were at the same level. In fact, he diminished himself and washed their feet. So on the day they will arrest Jesus, They needed somebody to identify him. Do you think that is happening in our churches today? When you enter the church, you know who the pastor is. You know who the bishop is. You know who the evangelist is. The chairs are made of gold. The chairs of the poor are made of wood. The chairs are elevated. There are barriers. He doesn't reply emails. He doesn't reply WhatsApp. He doesn't answer his call. He has 50, 60 bodyguards. But the Jesus that shed his blood for us on the cross, that had all the glory of this world, he needed someone to identify him, because he looked like every other apostle. Judas had to kiss Jesus to they didn't know Jesus. In fact, they had to pay Jesus. They paid him for identification. They had to induce Judas and pay him. Please take this money, 30 pieces of silver, and show us who Jesus is. We don't know him. It's like any other common man. That is the picture of humility. Humility breeds simplicity. Humility breeds simplicity. It breeds mutual respect. Imagine our pastors pastoring all the 85 million Nigerian Christians. Go on the altar, break down all those bottlenecks. The bottlenecks of, I want to see Papa, I will stay for 7 months, stay for 6 months. They break and pull those things down, and they make themselves accessible to the people. They make themselves real. They don't go on the altar and begin to make up stories. If they are feeling well, they tell the people, I am feeling well. If they're not feeling well, they don't pretend. That is one of the problems that we are having in Africa and in Nigeria. Leaders go on the altar and they hide their pains and weaknesses. It is one of the worst things you can do to your members as a leader. Going on the altar to hide your weakness, you are undoing them and setting a foundation of lies and deception for them in future. There is nothing wrong in telling people you are leading that you have weakness. Don't make yourself to appear like a thin god, a demigod. You cannot be sick. You can't have problem. It is one of the lies of the enemy. And I have seen this thing across many churches. Pastors don't think that they should be human. They are extra human. They are superhuman. So when you have headache, you say, you pretend. When you don't have money, you pretend. All your needs are always met. You never have any problem. Your children are the best in the world. When you send that picture to your followers, when they become leaders tomorrow too, they will not just do what you're doing, they will amplify it, they will expand it, they will enlarge it, and what they should have learned from you, the humility, the simplicity, the objectivity, they miss out on it. And they begin to wear two faces. They are going through pro and pain in their room, they come to you and begin to pretend. That is what humility kills. Imagine if all our pastors are mentoring and modeling Christians to become as humble as Christ. As humble as Christ. Imagine if they are telling them to start small. To start small. Starting small is not a crime. Remaining small is a crime. And they begin to teach them the dignity of labor. Working hard. Doing small, small things. Growing those small things to big. No, they won't tell them that. Now they tell them they become billionaire in 24 hours. Now, the only set of people that builds anything from the top to the bottom are grave diggers. The only set of people that build things from the top to the bottom are grave diggers. Everybody that has become great in life starts from the floor and they build up. Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, Rockefeller Foundation, everybody starts from the floor and go up. But no, what pastors will do is they will tell you that God will eliminate the law of process. And God will throw you from floor 1 to floor 50. And I have a problem with that. I have experienced miracles. I believe in miracles. God has used me to perform miracles. But I don't teach and train people on miracles. I don't build on miracles. Miracles are not sustainable. Miracles may happen now, may not happen in 20 years. Everybody that God blessed in scripture, more than 90% of them were blessed and raised by principles. Daniel, Joseph, Abraham, David, name all of those great people. all the people whose names are mentioned in the hall of fame of faith in the book of Hebrews, every one of them, they pass through training, process, preparation. God knows that when you pass through process and preparation, you will become tough, you become mature, you become strong, you have capacity, and then you begin, you'll be able to model other people for that process. But if that thing don't drop on your laps, every single person that has received a miracle from God, go and ask them to tell you their history. They have paid some prices. Hey, that person that got admission to Harvard University, out of 1,000 people, they chose 5 people and his name was there. He paid some prices. What Satan is doing is this. He makes people to diminish the value of hard work and to elevate miracles so as to confuse people, shift their attention from the principles, kingdom values of hard work, and you are running after God. Miracle, 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 miracle. There is no single human being on earth today that is dominating the world that did not go through process and hard work and labor. No single person. Imagine if our pastors go on the altar and they are mentoring and modeling people. There are times for miracle, there are times for hard work, and they preach 90% on principles, 10% on miracle. Imagine what will happen to the African and Nigerian society. But when you twist it around and you focus your message 90% on miracles, you have killed the people's motivation and morale for hard work. They don't want to work hard. They don't want to go to school. No business plan. No proposal. They don't want to engage in creative thinking. No rational thinking. No strategic thinking. They just want a rubber stamp God that gives them everything they want at any time, in any day, for any reason. That God is not the God of the Bible. God made sure that David was trained. David was anointed at the age of 17. He didn't climb that throne until 30. Joseph was anointed. Joseph got the dream at 17. He didn't become prime minister at 30. Abraham got the word from God at age 75. He didn't have Isaac until 100 years. 25 years of grooming. If God doesn't groom you, he will not use you. God doesn't use people he has not groomed. Every glory has a story. Anybody that tells you that he has become great by confessing greatness is telling you lie. He must have paid some prices sometime. It may not be this year, maybe last year. He has done something in the secret. He has done something in the secret somewhere. And those things are now used by God as raw material. God now blesses that person. Most of the things I'm telling you today, 25 years ago, I didn't know them. If I had known what I know today, the little I know today, if I knew them in the 1980s, in the 1980s, if I had known them, oh my God, I would be far by the grace of God, greater than where I am today. But unfortunately, I also lived in an environment of brainwashing, where we were brainwashed that God is a magic, that God is a rubber stamp, that anything you want, regardless of process, God will give you. We gave everything, gave our clothes, gave our shoe, gave our salary, removed the buttons of our shirts. We did all kind of crazy, unimaginable thing, and nothing happened. God ensured that we apply kingdom value system of hard work. Because God doesn't raise irresponsible children. God is not looking for babies that will be taking feeding bottle from him when they are supposed to be feeding other people. God made sure that he passed me through the furnace of fire. He made sure I trekked miles. He made sure I was hungry. He made sure I went through lack. I went through wants. I learned patience. I learned endurance. I learned respect. I learned dignity. I learned money management. I learned those things for many years. And when the time came, God now began to release me. Let me tell you something. Every Christian will follow 3 processes in God. Listen to this. There is a process called the process of revelation. Between the age of 0 and 12, Jesus went through the process of revelation. There is a next stage called the process of preparation. between 12 and 30, Jesus was prepared. There is a last one called the process of manifestation. Between 30 and 33, Jesus manifested. So you will go through revelation, you will go through preparation, you will go through manifestation. Look at the life of Joseph. Between 0 and 17 was revelation. He had dreams. He was sharing dreams with his brother. Between the age of 17 and 30 was preparation. He went to jail. He went to the pit. From 30 and above, it was manifestation. Look at David. Between the age of 0 and 17 was revelation. Between 17 and 30 was preparation. From 30 and above, David became the king. Every Christian will go through those phases. Sometimes God combines two phases in one. It is God. But that you will escape the process of God. This is a kingdom value system that churches need to teach people and mentor them and model them to raise strong citizens, to raise responsible children, to raise people who will have dignity, who will have credibility, who will have respect. If these things are not taught, there is nothing like greatness. God does not get people to the top and then begin to train them there. You must pass through the ranks and get trained and get mentored. Now, I'm telling you the value systems that are under the canopy of a kingdom that can transform any nation, that can change any nation. Endurance, integrity, all of these things are in Galatians chapter 5, verse 21 and 22. Now, you can see the connection between the church and society. So, when the church begins to churn out weak believers, selfish believers, disrespectful believers, believers who cannot endure anything, believers who are callous, who have no love for God, believers who are God users, people who don't want God to use them, they want to use God. If all churches are churning them out, or a vast majority, the nation will now be impacted negatively. The nation will feel the weight. The nation will feel the weight of the 85 million Christians in Nigeria. And the weight may not be palatable. There are some people, they are assets to the nation. One man can change a whole nation. I have said it over and over again. One man. All the countries in the world where we have had of great revolution, great development, only one man championed it. Even negative and satanic revolution, the terrorism of the Middle East, Osama bin Laden, only one man. One man is very powerful. One man is very powerful. How much more 85 million people that are heaven's representative on earth, that are kingdom disciples. Every one of these people, on a day by day, week by week, month by month, they go through different training, lecture, teaching, messages in their churches. If the messages they are hearing are training them to be egocentric, to be selfish, to be self-centered, to be in a hurry, to shun the law of process, and to want things immediately, the country will never develop. What we are seeing today will be a shadow of what will happen in the future. I'm not a prophet of doom. If things don't change and pastors don't sit up, or we pray all the bad eggs out, we pray them out. It's either they repent or we pray that God flushes them out. If we only have 10 people who will be committed to the kingdom values and they'll be training people, teaching people, it's better to have 10 kingdom value driven pastors than have 1 million egocentric preachers. It is better to have 10 kingdom driven pastors than having 1 million egocentric leaders who are churning out egocentric Christians, selfish believers, callous Christians, wicked Christians, loveless Christians. These people will go into all the mountains I described. Mountain of media, of entertainment, of culture, of education, of science and technology. They will get jobs, get contracts, they will be lecturers, and they will transfer all the negative value system that they have gotten from their churches. They will transfer it into all this mountain, and the country will continue to suffer for it. That is why when Jesus was going, he gave us that mandate. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his way of doing things, or his value system. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his value systems. And every other thing that you're looking for, development, prosperity, will be added unto you. You don't switch it around and you are pursuing all the other things and you diminish the kingdom values. It doesn't work that way. The kingdom must be given priority. Check the sermon notes of more than 80% of pastors in Nigeria and in some part of Africa. What are the contents of their sermon every Sunday? What are their practices? You can't be teaching kingdom values and you're not living kingdom values. They will not listen to you. You first must be an example of kingdom value before you can teach others. So you can't just go online, download some teachings, and go and teach people. You must demonstrate love before you are qualified to teach love. You must be humble before you are qualified to teach humility. You must be meek. You must have integrity before you are qualified to teach integrity. You will not have any credibility. People will not believe you. They will just see you as a charlatan. It's when you are living what you are saying that you become a credible source of mentorship. So that is the problem. Many pastors, truly, they teach some of these things, but they don't live it. You can't be teaching what you are not living. You lack credibility. Your messages will not carry weight. People will not believe what you are saying. The best way to mentor people is to live what you are teaching. You can't be teaching what you are not living. You can't mentor anybody. You can't mentor anybody. And that is the problem we have on our hands. 4 more days into 2018. How many pastors are ready to embrace change? How many are ready to comply with the blueprints given to us by the head of this kingdom? The president and chief commander. The commander-in-chief of this kingdom that has given us a blueprint, a manual. This is my manual that will help you to turn your society around. Make kingdom values priority. Make kingdom values. Don't make prosperity priority. Don't make holiness priority. Because when you have kingdom values, you will be holy. When you have these kingdom values, love, joy, peace, humility, holiness is bread and butter for you. You know that you must walk holy. You cannot love people and attack and fight them. Love will kill every appetite for sin in you. Love kills it. Of all of this value system, the number one that is most important is love. I look through all of this list. It is only God that will help us. We've got a very big problem on our hands. And my role and your role as brothers and sisters is to constantly lift up our voices. Everybody in your own sphere of influence is part of your own nation. So anybody you meet anywhere, in the shop, at school, make sure you are an avenue for kingdom value reorientation for them. Make sure you are an avenue. Like I said when I began, a man that is in love doesn't question people. Where is the government of your country? When you see problems, you fix them. When you are in love, you don't have any time for questioning. When you see problems, you fix them. Imagine if all our churches, all our ministries, every pastor becomes less egocentric. Let's even give it 10, 15, 20% reduction in egocentrism and divert some of the resources to fixing the society. Not asking government questions. Don't the government doesn't have money? Did Jesus ask the government of his time, Herod, what was his problem? He just came around fixing things. Jesus was fixing things. He was fixing the hungry, fixing the poor, fixing the sick. Everywhere he went, he was fixing things. The Bible says everywhere he went, he was doing good. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Everywhere Jesus went, he was fixing things. He had no time to ask questions. Potiphar, Herod, what was the allocation given to you this month? You should have fixed these people. They need food. Jesus fixed them because he is the number one epitome of love. Jesus is the number one epitome of love, and he has planted that love in our hearts. Romans 5:5 says, the love of Christ has been embedded in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. That love is like sugar in a tea. You've got to stir it up. Every Christian who is born again has a residue of love in his heart. But this thing will not come out until it is stirred up. Who stirs it up? You can do the stirring. Pastors can do the stirring by telling people the right things they should hear and conforming to kingdom value systems. Unfortunately, many of our brothers and sisters who are pastors in Africa, in Nigeria, they do not want to hear anything about what I'm saying. Everyone, not every, most of them are set out to build empires for them. Huh. Empires that will outlive them. Empires that will outlive them. One day is coming. They are going to die and face the judgment of God. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ and give an account of what we have done. Apostle Paul has written this thing in black and white. 1 Corinthians 3:13, he says, hey, the fire will test every man's work of what sort it is. Sort, S-O-R-T, not of what quantity, of what sort it is. It means of what quality it is. I did a message on quality and quantity. Go and listen to that message on my timeline. It will change your life. God does not reward quantity. He rewards quality. He said the fire shall test every man's work. Of what sort? S-O-R-T. Not of what quantity. Of what sort? You can do a little and affect the whole world. You can do plenty and not feel, and the world will not feel any impact. It is the quality of what you do that matters, not the quantity. It is not how much you do that matter, but how well you do the little that you can do. Because God doesn't reward quantity. He said he's going to reward quality. Quality. What is quality? How well have you done what I ask you to do? Did you obey me? Did you do the right thing at the right time and in the right way? That is called quality. Quantity is size. Quality is how you have done what you have done. And so if every pastor changes their orientation and mindset towards quality, you won't be under pressure to build a 100 million seat auditorium. You won't be under pressure to copy your friend. You are not moved. You are not bothered. You are just on your own track, focusing on quality. Because you know a day is coming, you are going to stand before somebody who will check that quality. Who will check that quality? He will not check the quantity, he will check the quality. And that is what has been driving me every day of my life. I make mistakes myself. I err myself. But I make sure I go back to God. I repent. I come back on track. I say, you are marking quality. Have I done the right thing? Is this the right thing I should do? Does it conform with kingdom values? If it doesn't conform, I will repent before God. Oh, I'm sorry. That is wrong. I'm sorry. And then I come back on track. So that is the thing that I have come to present to us today. Kingdom-driven church. That is the pillar. That is the solution that can bring transformation to the Nigerian society that I'm using as a case study. Until pastors go back to the blueprint, go back to the manual, there is nothing like I am called to preach prosperity. It is not in the scripture. There is nothing like I am called to teach holiness. Jesus didn't call anybody to go and teach prosperity. Said, go and preach the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom. The prophetic ministry, teaching ministry, apostolic ministry. Every one of them must produce people that have kingdom values. You can prophesy from morning to night. There is nothing wrong with it. But at the end of the day, your prophecy must produce Christians with kingdom values. You can do apostolic work, do evangelism work, teach people. At the end of the day, the products that come out of the manufacturing plants that you are watching over must produce people that have these kingdom values. If you can produce them, God is going to measure your reward using the quality of your production, the quality of people you have produced, the quality of people you have produced. It is unfortunate that the African society is not feeling the impact of the Christian population, because pastors have derailed from what Jesus said. Jesus said, go and preach the gospel of the kingdom. He said, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached, and then the end will come. Jesus said it. This gospel of the kingdom must be preached, and then the kingdom of God will come. Matthew 24 verse 14. Mark chapter 1 verse 14. The gospel of the kingdom is the solution to the societal problem Nigeria is having. I am using Nigeria as a case study tonight, and I want to provoke you, friends. I want to provoke you, my brothers and sisters, that you go into the new year seeing yourself as heaven's representative on earth, as kingdom diplomats, people who have been left in the world to change the world. Go into the 2018 that is coming as an agent of change. Make sure everyone that comes in contact with you sees another Jesus. Make sure everywhere you go and walk, they see another Jesus with kingdom value systems. Hard work, integrity, humility, love. When these things pervade our churches and we are raising people that are demonstrating these values, that is when the society will change, and these things will translate to development. The country will transform from a third world to a first world, because Christians will see themselves as solutions for electricity problems. We are solution for road problems. We are solution for hospital problems. We are solution to ritualist problems. And Christians will enter their different spheres of influence and use their resources themselves to fix those problems without waiting for the government. That is what Jesus stood for, being heaven's representative on earth. And that is what I stand for. Thank you very much. I believe you've learned a lot tonight. Please help me share this message on your timeline. Tomorrow is going to be the 28th edition of Value System Change Agenda. And I am dedicating the last 3 days, and like the one I did today, to the church. I have done a lot of teaching on the government, society. Now I'm focusing on the church. The Church of God in Africa has at least 300 million Christians. In Nigeria alone, there are 85 million Christians, professing Christians, professing Christians. And majority of them are part of the rots. Majority of them are giving bribes. Majority are giving bribes and taking bribes. And it is not their fault. It is the fault of what they are hearing. The people that are feeding them, they are the ones that are polluting them. If the pastors sit up and begin to teach kingdom value systems, and they diminish giving, and they put giving as a secondary thing, you have given your life to Christ already. What can't you give God? Don't focus on giving. Even every part of my life I've given to Christ. What is money? And they begin to elevate the values of humility and show the example, not teaching what they're not living. Whether you are archbishop or pastor or bishop, you diminish yourself to the level of Jesus. Unfortunately, many pastors are above Jesus now. They are above. Jesus is their assistant pastor. They are the pastor. And they are the one that gives instructions to Jesus now. They are the one giving Jesus instruction. Jesus' words are stinking. Jesus' words are smelling. Jesus' words are archaic. His words belong to 3,000 years ago. This is 21st century Africa. This is a generation where you use your brain. They diminish the words of Jesus. They put him as a spare tire. They are using their wisdom and their whims and compromises as their own main tire. Time will tell. There is no man on earth that will live forever. A day is coming that they are going to die. I don't wish anybody evil. I don't pray that they go to hell. I pray that God will open their eyes, open their hearts, and make everybody that has derailed to come back on track. All the people that have sold their souls to Satan, that have collected powers from Satan, and they are manipulating people. Satan doesn't have any free gifts. Satan will give you a cap, take away your head. Satan will give you a wristwatch, collect your hand. The day Satan will come and collect what he has given you, he will not just collect what he has given, he will collect more. The end result is hell. Many people have not seen hell. That is why they are diminishing it. Everybody that God has shown the revelation of hell, you will not pray that your worst enemy goes to hell for one day. It is the most horrific, horrendous, unimaginable, and eternal and everlasting torment. There is no pleasure on earth that can compensate you for hell. There is nothing that can be compared with it. How many years are you going to live on earth? Your membership is 500,000 members. And then you have 50 cars. You have 100 planes. You have this and that. For how many years will you enjoy it? A day is coming, you will die. And before it is too late, repent, return the devil's properties back to him. Satan has no free gifts. There is nothing you want in Christ that he cannot give you. Even if he doesn't give you on earth, when you get to heaven, you cannot partake of satanic terrestrial glory and partake of heaven's celestial glory. It can never happen. Nobody partakes of satanic terrestrial glory and partakes of celestial glory. You will either choose celestial glory and leave satanic terrestrial glory. You can't enjoy Satan and enjoy God. 1% Satan plus 99% God equals 100% Satan. It is either Jesus is Lord of all or not Lord at all. Jesus is either Lord of all or not Lord at all. You can't combine 1% Satan with 99% God. That is 100% Satan. God is a jealous God. It is either Jesus is Lord of all or not Lord at all. That is what is called kingdom value system that can transform a nation, that can transform a city, transform society, and raise a new breed of Christians that will make heaven proud and will make Jesus not to regret that he shed his blood on the cross. Many people are making Jesus to regret that he died because they are frustrating the grace of God. Apostle Paul says, do not frustrate the grace of God. Grace can be frustrated. Grace can be thwarted. You can frustrate God's grace by the way you live your life as a Christian and by the way you teach the gospel. This gospel we are preaching, it cost some people their blood. Some people are beheaded. Some people are fed to lions. David Livingstone, his hand was torn by a lion. He was exported from England to Africa, Uganda. David Livingstone, they begged him, go back to Britain. He was sick. He said he won't go back. He had an attack with a lion. A lion tore his hand and he died. When David Livingstone was dying, he said, take out my heart and bury my heart in Africa and take my body to England because it is in Africa that my heart is. They took out the heart of David Livingstone when he died and buried it in Africa. Took his corpse to Britain. These people paid fiery prices for our gospel. These people paid prices. The people that shed their blood, that lost their lives. Many of them are in heaven now. And what do you think they will be feeling? This gospel cost people their blood. That is why the Bible says, contend earnestly for the faith. This faith that you and I have cost people their blood. Many people are buried alive. Many were given to lions to eat. Many people in the Middle East, they have been massacred, assassinated because of this gospel. Many of these people that brought the gospel to Africa, they left their comfort. They left their houses. They left pleasure in Britain, in America, came to Africa. They built schools, built hospitals, built roads. They didn't ask the government, what is your own role? That is called kingdom-driven life. When you are kingdom-driven, kingdom value systems of love will be operating your life. When these white people came, they didn't ask us in Africa, doesn't your government have money? Why can't they fix your schools? Anywhere kingdom-driven people go and they see problem, they fix it. Typical of our master, the head of the kingdom, Jesus. Anywhere he went, he fixed the problems. So these people came and they shed their blood. They lost their lives. They lost everything to give us this gospel. That is why the Bible says we should contend harmlessly. We should contend. Everybody that is polluting that gospel, we should contend. Contend on our knees in prayer. Contend by saying the truth. Contend by writing against it. Not winning and writing against their personal lives, but writing against those doctrines. Because this gospel cost some people their blood. Some people paid for this gospel with their blood. Many of us have not lived in the Middle East before. We have supported people in the Middle East who are doing churches on the ground. Our church has sent money to them a couple of times. Many of them, when they catch them, they cut off their head. They bury them alive. And they hold meetings, nocturnal meetings. They hold it at night. Many of us carry our Bibles about. We are free. Nobody's harassing us because some people have paid the price for the gospel that we have today. And the Bible says we should contend harmlessly. The matter of the kingdom is a matter of contention. Matthew chapter 11 verse 12 says, this kingdom that we are, it suffers violence, and only the violent takes it by force. That stands for contention. You are not neutral. When they are polluting the gospel, you are not neutral. When they are desecrating the gospel, you are not neutral. You are ready made to contend. Not fighting with people, as in contending by standing for the truth and telling them what you are saying is against scripture. The Bible says this. The Bible says that, and you stand for the truth. That is what it means to contend. You contend. You raise up the banner of truth and righteousness and let people know. In my own territory, you cannot teach error. Error is not permitted in my territory. I have zero tolerance for error. I have zero tolerance for error. You can't desecrate the gospel, and I open my eyes and I'm alive. I will contend. I will make sure I speak out. I will make sure I write out. I will make sure I teach against that error. That is the only thing we can do. That is the only thing, the least thing we can do to show our appreciation to the people whose bloods have been lost to this gospel. This gospel is not cheap. Even though it is free, it is not cheap. It cost Jesus his blood. It cost so many apostles their blood. All the 11 apostles, 12 of them, were massacred, with the exception of John, that was banished to the island of Patmos. And these people contended for the gospel. When the Pharisees were twisting the head of Peter and were trying to do all kinds of things, Peter told them, he said, you judge whether it is right for us to obey men rather than God. We will obey God. When Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego were being rattled by the king, and they told him, whether it is right, even the God, our God whom we serve, is able to deliver us, even if he does not, we will not bow. They did not bow and they did not bow. These people did not have Bible. They didn't read scriptures. They didn't read book, but they had enough contention to defend the value system of the kingdom. That was during the Old Testament. What about where we are now? The Bible calls this dispensation better covenants established on better promises. You have a responsibility to stand for the truth. Stand for the values of the kingdom. Make the kingdom your utmost priority. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his value system. Every other thing is secondary. The kingdom of God and his value system is the principal. Every other things are vice principals. You must contend for this faith. Contend for this truth. Contend for it in your home, in your family, with your children. Raise up the banner of truth. Raise up the banner of righteousness. Contend for value systems. Kingdom value systems of love. Teach your children love. Show the example of love, meekness, and humility. Accept corrections. Teach them to accept corrections. As little as that stage is, it will form a set of value system in those children. and develop the capacity to obey the truth when they grow up. And this is what, by the grace of God, I stand for. And I'm trusting God to use you and I to be change agents in this generation, that you and I will not contribute to the existing mass of decadence. You and I will contribute to the alienation of the decadence, to the uprooting of decadence, so that posterity will not forget you and I. That when we came to this world, when you came to this world, and when I came to this world, we stood for only one thing: kingdom value system. Jesus gave us the mandate. We took the baton from him, and we want to give the baton of kingdom value system to our children and to everybody that we meet in our respective sphere of influence. That is what can transform a nation. That is the role of the church, committed to the dissemination, to the teaching, to the practice of kingdom value system. Jesus did not come to preach any other gospel. Jesus came to preach the gospel of the kingdom. Mark chapter 1 verse 14, Matthew 24, 14, and he said to us, even my rapture, even the end of the world is limited by the scope of the gospel of the kingdom. Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, and then the end shall come. And in other words, for the end to come, rapture to come, Jesus said, the Bible says, he's coming for a glorious church that doesn't have wrinkle or spot. That is a church committed to the gospel, to the message of the kingdom. A gospel, a church committed to the values of the kingdom. That is the church Jesus is coming to rapture. Not egocentric church, not self-centered church, not church that is teaching people sew seat, sew this, sew cloth, sew button, sew shoe. They will soon get to a point they will tell us to sew our wives and sew our husbands. I know that is going to happen very soon. Maybe it will happen in our generation. Maybe in the next 20 years or 50 years, they will ask us to sew our children. Donate your wife. Donate your husband. These things are happening. And worse things may happen if you and I don't stand up and contend for this faith. There is no neutrality. Neutral people have no regard in heaven. Neutral people have no respect in heaven. God, Jesus was speaking to John in Revelation, talking about a church. I wish you were hot or cold. I wish you were hot or cold. Telling you that heaven has no regard for neutral Christians. Christians who sit on the wall, they know the truth. They cannot stand for the truth. No. Jesus told John, I wish you were hot or cold. But now that you are neither cold or hot, I will throw you out. I will spill you out in the New Testament. This didn't happen. If it had happened in the book of Genesis, people will say, oh, that was under the law. This happened after Jesus had died. Telling you and I, God has zero tolerance for neutrality. You cannot be neutral and command attention in heaven. You cannot be neutral and command attention in heaven. Of course, you will go to heaven, but you can't be neutral and command attention. The people whose rewards will be big, will be great, are those who contend for the faith, are those who are channels for the dissemination of kingdom values. That is what will bring the kingdom of God to the earth, and will make the coming of Jesus truly glorious, so that he can come and rapture a glorious church. That is the message that the Lord has given me to the body of Christ. And I thank God that you have waited patiently tonight. It's quite late, but I thank God you have seen and heard this message tonight. Please help me share this message on your timeline. Time is not on our side. Time is not on our side. We are living on the threshold of eternity. We are living on the threshold of history. Many of the prophecies that are given in scripture, many have been fulfilled. And many are being fulfilled at alarming rates that you and I are not aware of. Jesus, God Almighty, and the Holy Spirit, they are one. They have given us a mandate, a blueprint. Every pastor, every bishop, every archbishop, every evangelist in Africa, in Nigeria must go back to the original blueprints. Compare what you are teaching. Compare your Sunday school manual. Compare your workers manual. Compare your weekly programs with the values of the kingdom. If there are any gaps, bridge that gap now and return to the original, authentic gospel of the kingdom. For this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, and then shall the end come. Within 5 years, if Nigerian leaders, Christian leaders, embrace in its entirety the gospel of the kingdom, in 5 years, that country will be transformed. One church in Nigeria will foot the school fees, pay the tuition fees of 10 million Nigerians. One church in Nigeria will feed all the hungry free of charge in a year. One church in Nigeria will repair scores and dozens of roads. One church in Nigeria will fix this, will fix that, because they have returned to the authentic and original gospel of the kingdom. That is the blueprint that we have been given. And I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, like Apostle Paul. I am not ashamed of the gospel of the kingdom. This is the authentic gospel. Every other gospel is fake. There is nothing like gospel of prosperity. They are all man-made variants of the original gospel. There is nothing like the gospel of holiness. There is nothing like that in scripture. All of these things are variants. Holiness, prosperity, discipleship, they are all under the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom is the nucleus, is the centrality, is the core of the gospel that Jesus came to die for. And that is what you and I have been called to embrace. It is my prayer that every pastor, every Christian leader, they will receive inspiration from the Holy Spirit, and they will go back to God, and they will look at what they have been preaching. Why is it that what you have been preaching doesn't have effects on the nation? And they will make the correct changes, and they will make necessary changes. It is pride to see the truth and to rationalize it. And that is what I've got this evening to tell you. I believe you've learned a lot. Join me again tomorrow, 1 p.m. That is going to be 1 p.m. New York and Toronto time, and 6 p.m. UK time, 7 p.m. West African time, for the 28th edition of Value System Change Agenda. It's going to be explosive. I trust God for grace. Bible says it is not those that hear the word that are justified, those that are the doers of the word. John 14:15, Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commandments. So it's not just hearing it. I am speaking to myself too as I'm speaking now, because there are so many gray areas in my life. And so I'm just a channel. Many times when I finish speaking, I go back to the message and listen all over again. I am just a channel. I'm not better than everybody listening to me. We are all equal in Christ and the same in Jesus. And so I'm just a vessel and a channel. And I believe that God is going to use every one of us in this next move of God. God is raising generations of Davids all over the world. That is a prophetic word God gave to me. Is raising a new breed of leaders, not necessarily pastors, leaders across every sphere who are David. The Saul generation is being retired, even though they are still on the throne, because God is the only employer that fires people and keeps them on their job. That is the mystery of our God. He will be raising David, he will keep Saul on the throne until David is mature. A lot of Davids are being raised now who will take over the baton of leadership from the current leaders of the church in Africa. And the Davids are being raised secretly. Some of these Sauls, everybody is not a Saul, don't get me wrong. Some of the leaders are Saul. They will do everything to kill the David. They will throw javelin at David. They will send their Jonathans after David. They will trap David in the wilderness. But God will never allow them to catch up with David. And when their time is up, God will remove the crown from their head and will elevate all the Davids that are being raised all over Europe, America, in part of Africa, and replace them. And I want to commend everyone listening to this broadcast. It takes people who have a heart for the truth to listen to what I'm saying tonight. It takes people whose hearts are ready to hear the truth. And I want to commend you that we all come together and form a new generation of leaders. Leaders in politics, leaders in engineering, in health. And you start this kingdom value movement in your homes. Start this kingdom value movement in your homes. Start it in your homes. Take it outside into your places of work. And let our societies become better for it. We must contend for this kingdom and contend for this faith. Thank you so much. God bless you so much. I love you all. And I pray that at the end of the day, when our time is up on earth, we will hear only one word. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. That is the greatest compliment any man can receive. No other compliments. Nothing else is bigger. Nothing else is weightier. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Not successful servant. Now, thou good, the Bible uses that word, good and faithful servant. You can be successful and not be faithful. But you can't be faithful and not be successful. So faithfulness is a higher level of reward than success. And so I pray for you tonight that God will help you and I. We will hear that word from God. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You won't labor in vain. You won't spend all this year serving God and get to heaven and discover that your reward is minor. That will not be your portion in Jesus' name. God will help us and strengthen us. We will finish strong and we will finish well. Join me tomorrow again, 1 p.m. New York and Toronto time, 6 p.m. UK time, and 7 p.m. West African time. You are blessed. Have a sweet night rest. Thank you so much, everybody. God bless you.